We'll get to those stories in a moment, but first we've got breaking news today. There's a major rescue operation which is underway off Snapper Rocks at Coolangatta on the Gold Coast. So these pictures are just in from our news chopper where a whale is caught in shark nets and workers from SeaWorld are currently on the way to help set that whale free. We're thinking at this stage that it might be a humpback. That's yet to be confirmed. It's unclear at this stage how it became entangled.
Probably fortunately the weather is okay up there this morning, so they'll be able to get in there. But that's not a small whale. Hopefully they'll be able to get in there and cut the net away. They're pretty experienced at that. We've seen over the years. Our SeaWorld staff are just incredible. So we'll bring you up to speed with that a little bit later in the program, the debate. Meantime, on shark nets, I'm sure we'll go on. Well, in the last few moments, the cracks in Sydney's route out of lockdown in the heart of government have been exposed right here on the Today Show, if you saw it. Police Minister David Elliott confirming there was disagreement over when restrictions should start to ease.
Felt yesterday that the cracks are showing, and really, no wonder people are left confused.
Well, that's right, and it is because there is no playbook when it comes to responding to a pandemic. But as far as the New South Wales Police are concerned, and as far as I'm concerned, we receive the public health orders from the Minister for Health, and we make sure that compliance is met. My appeal to the community is to understand the public health orders, understand what the compliance obligations are and follow them. But, I saw that footage yesterday and my view is that the Premier has accepted the fact that the buck stops with her and she'll make those decisions, I think, balancing up both the health advice, mental health of the community.
It was a pretty revealing interview. More of that a little bit later in the program if you've missed it. We've got comprehensive coverage across the country for you at home this morning. First to Today Sydney reporter Gabrielle Boyle at Liverpool Hospital. Gabby, we could see another day of some pretty bad numbers.
Yeah, that's right, Carl. We had pretty bleak numbers yesterday and it's likely to be reflected in the numbers today when they're announced by the Premier at her 11 a.m. press conference. In the past 24 hours, 356 fresh COVID cases, 57 of those out and about in the community. It's likely we're going to see similar numbers again today. Liverpool Hospital tragically has announced the death of a man in his 80s from COVID-19. He is the sixth death they've had at this facility in Western Sydney. And a Bexley nursing home has a big problem on their hands. They've got four cases at that facility. Thankfully, 85% of residents have had at least one jab. And if you're living in the inner west and you do have to get out and about because you're an essential worker or you need to see a doctor or get a vaccination, well, the bus services won't be running at capacity. In fact, 19 inner west bus services have been cancelled over the next 48 hours. And that's due to the fact that two people have tested positive at the depot and it's had that knock-on effect, meaning bus drivers have also been stood down as close contacts. Carl?
Gabby, thank you.
Construction workers in Sydney's COVID hotspots are back on the tools today, but they can't work without having at least one jab. Today correspondent Lara Vella is at Parramatta Square in Sydney's West. Lara, how many workers can return to sites?
Well, Ali, today worksites will still be operating at just 50% capacity, but no doubt tradies who live in those hotspot areas in our suburbs, in our west and southwest, will be very, very keen to come back to work because they've effectively been banned from these worksites for the past 3 weeks. It's forced everything from huge major infrastructure projects across our suburbs to be put on hold to also dozens and dozens of home renovations. Today, though, those tradies will once again be allowed to pick up tools, but there are some conditions. They'll either have to be fully vaccinated, or for the ones that have had only their first jab in the last 3 weeks, they'll also have to produce regular negative COVID tests. This morning, it's still pretty quiet here at Parramatta. We've seen a smattering of some of the boys back in high-vid vests. I think one of the issues here, Ali, is going to be access to the vaccines. The state government, though, they are helping out here on Sunday. They're going to have a mass vaccination drive, particularly targeting construction workers at Sydney Olympic Park.
Thank you, Lara.
COVID has made its way back into yet another regional city in New South Wales. Residents in Dubbo in the central west urged to get tested. The latest case is linked to two schools, Dubbo West Public and Macquarie Anglican Grammar, with all staff and students in isolation. It was only a fortnight ago several LGAs in that region emerged from a snap lockdown. Lockdown 6.0 is expected to be pushed till at least early next week, an announcement expected this morning. Let's go to today's Isabella Staskowski from Carolyn Springs testing site, which is just open, mind you. Isa, good morning to you. Locals say they've had to return for a second day in a row.
Our COVID commander has said that testing in this area is simply far too low, but residents that I've spoken to say they've had to return for a second day because they tried to get tested yesterday and it was just too busy. I want to show you what the line looks like here this morning. You can see there are so many people out here bright and early. It is freezing cold and it is very windy. They are braving some pretty unfavourable conditions. Many of them have been here since 7 a.m. and as you say, it is just opening right now. This area is a key concern because mainly of the Caroline Springs Square shopping centre. That's only some 700 metres away from where we are right now. And I can tell you that that whole entire shopping centre is now a tier one site for almost all of last week. All staff who were there Monday to Thursday will need to isolate for 14 days. Here are some of those people we've spoken to in the line.
We missed out yesterday. So we missed out yesterday. Earlier.
So we come to this morning early.
Because they were packed everywhere.
So I did try yesterday, but just came back first thing this morning.
There are also concerns for the Royal Children's Hospital because a doctor connected to that facility has tested positive. And this morning, almost 300 exposure sites right across Greater Melbourne. And Alex, the prediction is that today's case numbers will again be in the double digits.
Not good, is it? Thank you.
Queensland's first mass vaccination hub will be opening in the next few minutes. Today, Queensland reporter Jess Millwood is there for us. Jess, how will it operate?
Carl, good morning to you. Well, by the weekend, it's hoped 3,000 jabs will be administered every single day here at the Convention and Exhibition Centre. Briefings are just happening right now, so the doors have been closed, but very soon it will open to the public. The first appointment is at 8:30, and this will operate between 8:30 and 4:30, 7 days a week to supercharge Queensland's vaccination rate. It will be for between 16 and 59-year-olds to receive the Pfizer vaccine, the second dose of AstraZeneca will be offered. This is not a walk-in clinic. People need to go on and make a booking online. And to do that, they need to register with Queensland Health. The number of people waiting for a booking has dropped slightly, I'm told this morning, to just over 200,000. There are going to be around 70 staff working here. And Carl, just finally, today is D-Day for Cairns. They are currently in lockdown, due to come out this afternoon. It is looking good for the people of the far north after they recorded zero COVID cases yesterday.
Jess, thank you.
Hey, let's check your sport. And a quest for another premiership is the driving factor behind George Burgess's return to the NRL. Plagued by a chronic hip injury, George says he'll be back running next month ahead of pre-season training with the Dragons.
I just feel like my time's not finished. I don't know. I mean, I spoke to a lot of people that have retired and they say, you know, when you know, you know. And I just don't feel like I know that yet.
And in somewhat of a win for the Giants, vice-captain Toby Green will now miss only one match after successfully challenging his two-match striking ban at the AFL judiciary. His representative argued that Dangerfield fell and that Green had 0.12 seconds to react between possession and contact.